All right, let's move on because Geelong, to a certain degree, shot themselves in the foot.
St Kilda all too late, unfortunately. So they're making a good play late in the season, but there's a lot of coaches that'll say, you know, why do you do it when it's late in the piece? You know, these late wins meaningless in terms of when it counted?
They are, Lord.
They are. And this was a great win. And what I like about St Kilda is the ball movement. We've questioned them. I've questioned them. We said, you know, we thought about that win against the Gold Coast Suns. It was a nothing. This was a good win. Mm. They played a great brand of football. But again, well, they'll be judged on the first 7-8 rounds of next year, Damo.
There's a false comfort, Lordo, in teams that do this late in the season. Yeah. I really feel that. Adelaide had a component tilt before they were again exposed last night against Port Adelaide. St Kilda's doing it. I know they've had issues. I know their list is not as good on paper as other clubs. But there's no good, no point winning matches at this stage of the year late when it doesn't count and mean anything. The loss, though, does count and mean something against Geelong because they were positioned well after that Fremantle win the previous week to finish top four, but they've now exposed themselves to other teams now controlling where they finished.
Where do you see them, Brownie?
Well, I'm just concerned about their midfield and whether it is a premiership midfield. When Patrick Dangerfield, you're going into a game and he is still your best player and your best midfielder, they actually rank 16th disposals conceded against other midfield. So when you're going into a game and you're giving up so much midfield disposal, it is hard to win. It's hard to feed your own forwards and it's hard to help out your defenders when you're giving up so much ball. I think they've got the weakest midfield in the top eight at the moment. They'll probably finish fourth and get Sydney. Sydney aren't going that well at the moment, but I've got a real concern about the Cats being in the top eight.
Just that brings me to my point, and you were happy to discuss this on air. You said off air in our production meeting they're the worst team in the eight at the moment.
Worst is a strong word.
Well, you said that.
In the top eight, I don't think they can win the premiership this year. So that's what I'll say. On the back of all the teams that are in the top eight, on the back of their midfield, and if they do, it's a monumental effort from their leaders like Jeremy Cameron, Patrick Dangerfield, and to more extent, Chris Scott, to build a game plan to suit that midfield.
All right, and the comment was made a little earlier. The Giants, the form team of the competition. At the
they are, and the best players do the simple things well. And that's where Joey Danaher, we're critical of him, because he does too many things that are outside what he needs to do. But Jesse Hogan, 10 goals clear in the Coleman now, he's just doing everything well. Like, he's a colossus in terms of his contested marking. He's the player who's the most accurate in the comp with his set shot goal kicking. He brings other players into the game. He's just doing everything. And what a story. Like, I question, what are the Giants doing taking this guy? He's let himself down at two previous clubs. Why would you take him? But to his credit, he's comfortable, he's happy in Sydney, and he's doing what he should have done.
And when they got him, Lordo, to your point, they weren't even convinced he could get 15 matches per season into his system, and now he's playing full seasons and winning Collins.
I don't think there's any dispute that Brent Daniels is now the best small forward in the game. I think that is a universal opinion that we can all agree on. He's doing this. His game yesterday, I'm going to do the votes later, but he's a perfect 10. He comes up the ground and Fremantle had no answers. Just watch. So he's involved twice there. They allow him to drift back inside forward 50. His work rate and his defensive ability is as good as anyone. So his numbers yesterday, 29, 3 goals. He had 13 tackles. He had 7 clearances. He plays a team first role. So his role there is to guard the corridor to stop Fremantle coming back through, but then he's doing this, so his ability now to really inflict the damage on the scoreboard. This was as good a game as you've seen. Just the little things like that, doing the right things at the right time, and then to finish off your work with this, like that, that's just pure class. Brent Daniels, the best small forward in the game, and his performance yesterday, as good as the individual performances we've seen from anyone this year.
The D's finally shook off the Suns, and in many respects, this was all about Jack.
It was. Jack Viney was terrific yesterday through the midfield. He made a statement game. Max Gawn played under duress as well. Obviously, Clayton Oliver wasn't out there. But 30 disposals, 9 clearances, 10 tackles. Almost the perfect midfield hard nuts game. And then he added 2 goals to it. More importantly, 10 score involvements. And I know there's been talk about him potentially going to North Melbourne. But Jack Viney, just as hard as they come through the midfield, just his best game for the year, I think. He's been down, like a lot of the other midfielders, across the board at Melbourne throughout this year. But this has been his best game.
And the performance came, Brownie, at the end of a long week where, again, Melbourne's culture was questioned. Alex Neil-Bullen's decision for family reasons to want to return to Adelaide. Christian Petrarca refusing to shoot down Tom Morris's report that he was disgruntled with the footy club. And then Viney himself being linked to North Melbourne post-match was asked about that.
And I'm confident of the future of this footy club. And it's been a disappointing season, but we're going to keep chipping away. And I'm really confident we can get back to our best soon.
And you're not going anywhere?
No, we'll get through the season and we'll see how it pans out.
He left it open-ended there. He is
he's
obviously
gone.
Got a decision to make.
He's gone.
Look,
not overly confident now that I've seen that.
I just can't see a scenario where Jack Viney, the Melbourne Football Club's Jack Viney, leaves the Melbourne Football Club by his own.
How old is he?
There's been bigger names to leave the Melbourne Football Club.
What do you mean by his own? That'll be how it happens, by his own choice, wouldn't it?
That's what I mean. I can't see a scenario where that is the case. I mean, North will offer more money, more term, more years, but he's as loyal a player I think we've ever seen in football to this point. So I'd be surprised. It's just an opinion I've got on this story. North is clearly in the market for that type of player. They wanted to get Scott Pendlebury. He's re-signed at Collingwood. Luke Parker, that type. Callan Ward, Jack Viney. They want one, maybe two of that type of player from next year onwards.
All right, Friday night we cast our minds back to the Swans grinding out a win over the Bombers.
Yeah, so it was the last quarter against Collingwood that you thought, is this going to flick the switch for the Swans who had been out of form? And it was. So what we're showing here is a third quarter goal. Braden Campbell was brilliant. I just thought he's a player who's had a lot of talent. He started to get involved. Heaney's been the one. And it was six goals in this third term that really got the game back on their terms. Haywood, you're going to see here, he's a really important player. He kicked three. So I'm not fully convinced on Sydney and the way that they're going. And Brownie will speak about their tall forwards in a moment with a couple of the injuries that they've got. Chad Warner, Damo's man, withdrew with a tight calf. Not sure how serious that is, Damo.
Well, they said it was only a one-weeker, but now that they've almost secured top spot, regardless of result next weekend, I'd be resting him for the first week of finals.
So the tall forwards are the thing that you need to worry about with Sydney. I think their midfield is stacked, as we know. I think defensively, they're very sound. But Marty's kicks the 37 goals. Nine of those were in the one game. Then you've got McDonald and McLean. So when the ball went in there the other night against the Bombers' defence, it was still Heaney who went forward. It was Haywood. Obviously, no Tom Papley there. But it's the smaller players that need to get the job done. And going into a final series, Kane, have you got confidence of those three tall forwards can get the job done?
No, I don't. They need to get Papley back quickly as well. So if you've got Heaney and then you've got Haywood and Papley and one of those key forwards can stand up. But often it's not the key forwards, Lordo, that stand up in big finals. They just got to play their role.
Yeah, that's right, Kane. On the Bombers side of it, Brad Scott's got an issue. Number one is their inside 50 entries are appalling, so they're just not functioning in the forward line. And I think in defence, they have too many guys that kick it sideways. So I call them the crabs of the Bombers. So McGrath crabs it sideways, Laverty crabs it sideways, Jake Kelly crabs it sideways. You shouldn't be allowed to kick it backwards in this game in terms of he's conceded 30 metres there, McGrath. And then he goes backwards to what you should only be allowed to do that if the player can play on, because then he gets it back and he's worse off. They've given away 15 or 20 metres. This one, into the corridor, give the handball off to the player who can then go and test the opposition. He doesn't give it. And then where's he going to go sideways? So Sydney loved this after halftime. This is the reason the Bombers only kicked 8 goals on the night, because they refuse to take you on, and Sydney's defence set far too often. So that's an issue over the off-season.
Well, it's unfortunate for you that you often are the face of the Essendon situation. You made the comments at the start of the year, again, in context, that the Tullamarine facility would be burnt down if they failed to make finals. I'm paraphrasing a wider conversation, but that's where the club is now at. For the second year in a row, they have fallen away dramatically and quite embarrassingly.
Yeah, they have. And as I said, you can see the anger there. So I made that point.
Yeah, I don't think any of them are arsonists, by the way.
I think it's the way, Damo, they've lost again. 2 years in a row, they've been in wonderful situations to make finals and they've missed out again.
It's a poor fall. I mean, David Barham came in 2 years ago threatening and promising to change the whole dynamic of the footy club. And here we are 2 years later. A year after Ben Rutten had made finals, they'd sacked him, and nothing's changed, ultimately.
What's wrong, Kane?
Very funny. That was a great...
Is it because I mentioned fire?
No, it was a great one-liner.